Please note, the viewers might experience poor audio or video quality because of webcast from homes. Please be patient with us. I would request you to check your internet connectivity as well. Next slide, please. Today, we have a very interesting topic for you all, music therapy for managing anxiety. And to take us through the topic, we have with us Ms. Purva Sampath. Next slide, please. Next slide, yeah. Purva Sampath, the founder and director of Maya's Universe, is a graduate from Berklee College of Music and one of the few CBMT board certified music therapists and NMT, neurologic music therapist in the country. Purva was also a student music therapist in some of the top institutions like Perkins School for the Blind, Beth Israel Deaconess Medical Center and Boston Children's Hospital in Massachusetts, USA. She worked with a variety of populations from children and young adults at A Place to Be, an award-winning expressive arts therapy organization. She also specialized in working with the mental health population during her time at Innova's Behavioral Health Facility in Virginia, USA. In Bangalore, India, she works as a music therapist with multiple institutions, including CARBAMS, a psychiatric hospital and residential facility, FAME, India, which caters to individuals with neurodevelopmental disorders and other organizations that work with the differently abled, and Nightingale's Trust for Alzheimer's and Dementia Care. She also teaches introductory courses on music therapy at Women's Christian College in Chennai and St. Xavier's College in Mumbai, and presented at CMTAI's Creative Movement Therapy Association India International Conference in 2018. Purva was also recognized for her work in music therapy by the Rotary Downtown Chapter's HR Pratibha Award for Women of Distinctive Vocation 2019. For the convenience of everyone, we would be happy to take the questions at the last and would request you to please enter in the Q&A tab. Now, without taking any more time, I would request Ms. Purva Sampath to please take over from here. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Vaishali. I'd like to begin by welcoming you all to this webinar. I'm very grateful to have this opportunity to be here and to talk to you all about something that is very important to me and my life revolves around. So to start off with, there will be a couple of interactive questions that I will ask you and activities that we'll do together. So if you can type in your responses into your chat box, that would be great so that I can take a look at it and incorporate that into our session. To start off with, I have a very simple question for all of you. What does music mean to you? Whatever comes to your mind right off the top of your head, please go ahead and type those responses in. Okay, so I'm seeing magic. I'm seeing pleasant, joy. Music is life, relaxation. Way to soothe, musti, helps to reduce stress. It's a lullaby, it's entertainment, it's romantic, it's food for soul. So everything that you are connecting to music with, if you see, are emotions, right? So you are connecting to music using various emotions, using how music makes you feel, and connecting it to events or experiences that you've had in your life. So at this point, what I would like you all to do is to sit back in your chair, close your eyes, and think about the second question that's on the screen. What is your very first memory of music? I would like you to think about where you were, who you're with. What is that memory that you have where you remember and say, this is the first time I remember listening to music, or I remember a particular song, right? I'm already beginning to get responses. So Dr. Meena says that classical singing classes in the neighborhood, And Dr. Rupanjan Roy says, perhaps my mom sneezed. That's the earliest that I remember. Somebody says, Chitrahar, Rangoli, Vivo, 1820. M. Amarnath says, during school days, when we were in kindergarten, singing together in bhajan in the evening with the whole family during childhood. Morning Suprabhatam by M.S. Subbalakshmi. Yes, that's one of my first memories too. So if you actually look at the kind of responses that you are sharing within this chat box, it's very evident that while your first memory of music might have been a song in itself, you are also remembering so many things around that. You are remembering where you were. You're remembering the people that maybe sang that song to you. Some of you are thinking about families, your mothers. Some people are thinking about classes. Some people are thinking about school. Chances are some of you are even imagining the place that you were in. Maybe you're imagining your childhood bedroom, or you're imagining what your classroom looked like, or you're imagining what your music teacher looked like all those years ago. So this just goes to show how music is so integral, and it behaves as a trigger for our memory, right? We'll look into this more and understand this more as we progress in this session. Thank you all for your responses. I wish I could read all of them, but this is great. I'm loving the participation. So if you look at a dictionary definition of what music is, it is defined as the science or art of ordering tones or sounds in succession, in combination, and in temporal relationships to produce a composition having unity or continuity. Basically, to put it in simpler words, it is vocal, instrumental, or mechanical sounds having rhythm, melody, and harmony. So basically, when you say science or art of ordering tones or sounds in succession, it just means a particular way in which sounds are put one after the other, right? So sometimes they come in combinations, sometimes they come one after the other. And temporal relationships, or temporal just means in relationship to time. So in a fixed amount of time, you have different sounds that come together one after the other in a combination. And when you have a series of sounds like this, that's when you have a composition, or what you call a piece of music. So essentially, music is made up of five elements. You have rhythm, right? So rhythm is anything that has a beat, anything where the beat stays consistent throughout. You have pitch. Pitch is nothing but, if anybody's classically trained here or you enjoy listening to music, you know that classical musicians always have a Shruti box, right? Or they have an app these days that they use. But essentially, pitch is the key in which you sing a particular song. You have melody. So melody is usually what the vocalist or the main instrument in an instrumental piece of music plays or sings. And you have harmony. Harmony is what your chords sound like. So if you have a singer that's singing, if Arita is singing, then all everything that the guitar and the piano in the background is what melody is. And finally, you have timbre. Now, timbre is one of the most mystical. When you look at it, it doesn't come out a lot when you're talking about music. But timbre is essentially the quality of sound. So when I say quality of sound, I'm talking about how you can differentiate from my voice to a male voice, and how you can differentiate from my voice to the sound of a guitar, or to the sound of a piano, or to the sound of a keyboard, or even to the sound of a drum. So my voice quality or my sound quality is unique to who I am. That's why a lot of people prefer some singers over the other, because of their quality of tone or quality of voice. And that's essentially what timbre means. So how does all of this make sense when it comes to music therapy? Right. So before we go ahead and talk about how music is used as therapy in music therapy, let's take a quick look to understand what music therapy is. So music therapy is the clinical and evidence-based use of music interventions to accomplish individualized goals within a therapeutic relationship by a credentialed professional who has completed an approved music therapy program. Now, this is the definition that the American Music Therapy Association has come up with. So let's just break it down for a quick second. Understand the words that make up this definition. So when you say clinical or evidence-based, it means that music therapy, what music therapy is today, is years and years of research, right? It's not just saying that, oh, this music will work for this, or maybe we can try playing this instrument with a particular client, but it is actually clinically tried. And
ma'am, we lost you.
Oh, sorry. Let me try turning off my video. 1 second. Am I better now?
Yes, ma'am, audible.
Okay, great. I'll just begin with the definition. So music therapy is the clinical and the evidence-based use of music. So when you say clinical or evidence-based, it means that it's been proven through years and years of research, right? The minute you say something is clinical, it means there is a particular structure that is put to it. So the clinical and evidence-based use of music interventions. So when you say intervention, it is an activity or it is a concept that you are introducing as in to intervene a particular behavior, right? So when you say music interventions, it means music is the tool that you are using to intervene. To accomplish individualized goals. So we say individualized goals because when it comes to therapy in general, not just music therapy, it is never one size fits all, right? So anytime a client comes in, even if they have the same diagnosis on paper as another client, their goals are individualized to their own life or to their own journey and their struggles with their daily living activities. So making sure that you don't generalize, like as an example with autism, there is a tendency to generalize. So make sure that you're looking at individualized goals for each of your clients. So, and this happens within a therapeutic relationship. So a therapeutic relationship means that as a therapist, it's a one-way relationship. Right? I'm not sitting there with my client and sharing my life. Rather, I'm holding a safe space and building a therapeutic relationship with my client so that the client feels comfortable enough to open up and be vulnerable within those four walls of a therapy session. And music therapy is done by a credentialed professional who's completed an approved music therapy program. Now, the reason this last bit is important is because if you aren't trained and if you aren't a credentialed professional, then the kind of damage that you can do with a client through trial and error is a lot more. So you're putting both your client and yourself at risk as a professional if you don't understand what music therapy really is and if you haven't taken your time to study that in order to be a music therapist. Having said that though, today's session I'm going to be doing a few activities with you and giving you tips that you can use for yourself as well as with your families and with your patients at your hospitals or your clinics. So while you can definitely use music as a therapeutic intervention, just be reminded and keep in mind that when you use music with your clients or with your patients, it doesn't make you a music therapist necessarily. What it makes you is somebody who is an ally of music therapy. So you are helping me and helping the entire profession in spreading that knowledge of why music is therapeutic. So just a little bit about why music works the way it does and why human beings process music the way we do. So the auditory system is the first system to fully develop in a fetus between the 19th and the 25th week of pregnancy. It means that we understand and process the world around us while we're in the womb through sound. The second thing is neuroplasticity. So human beings have brains which have this incredible ability to learn and grow over time. Right? So neuroplasticity is the brain's ability to create new neural pathways even when a part of it gets damaged. And because of this neuroplasticity, we use music as a tool to be able to help the brain relearn certain things, like it could be walking, it could be gross motor movement, fine motor movement, speech and language. Music is a great tool that helps you and your brain relearn certain activities that you might have lost due to neural damage or due to a neural deficiency. Now, music is one of the only activities that engages both the right and the left hemisphere, right? And human beings have this innate ability to entrain to rhythm. Now, let me give you an example of what entrain to rhythm means, or rhythmic entrainment. So I'm going to clap, and what I would like you all to do is to just begin to clap with me, all right? So you might have noticed that it was really easy for you to clap with me. I'm hoping that the audio was working all right for that bit. But you would have noticed that it maybe took two or three claps to fall into rhythm with me. And that is because of your ability to enter into rhythm. If some of you go to a gym, or if you listen to music and work out, or if you like to take walks while listening to music, more often than not, you will notice that your steps are in rhythm to the song that you are listening to. So rhythmic entrainment is a tool that we use extensively when we're working with clients who are recovering from stroke, or when we're working with clients who are learning how to use their fingers again, or even when we're working with clients that we are helping regain speech. Now, passive listening versus active music making. So while a lot of us listen to music, maybe when we're traveling to work, or when we're sitting at home, or as a way for us to relax, active music making is what actually lights up different areas of your brain. If you look at this image, when you look at the one on the right-hand side that says the brain's reaction to music, you realize that multiple areas are lit up over there, right? So when you, let's say you're doing something as simple as clapping along and singing Twinkle Twinkle Little Star with me, that means one, your motor cortex is involved, your auditory cortex is involved because you're listening to me and singing along with me, your speech and language areas are involved because you are singing words, and you are also using your memory area in your brain because you are remembering maybe the first time you listened to it, or you're remembering how you used to be in your kindergarten class when you learned it. And so you have multiple areas of your brain that are engaged when you do something as simple as clap along or sing along to a song. So I hope you keep this in mind for the rest of our activities, because I'm going to want all of you to participate as much as you can from your own homes. Now, who is music therapy for? Ideally, when I have a client that comes to me, there are five areas that I look at when I'm assessing them, right? So we look at cognitive challenges first. So when I say cognitive challenges, we're talking about neurodevelopmental disorders, right? So anybody that might have difficulty in, say, speech or language, where it is a processing issue in the brain more than it is a speech production issue. It could be learning different patterns or sequences. So if you have worked with the population of autism, or if you know somebody in your own family or in your community, you will notice that a lot of the times they understand things at a face level, right? So they don't understand cause and sequence, or they might not understand cause and effect either. A lot of the times, being able to differentiate between shapes and colors, all of these come under cognitive challenges. So your brain has trouble processing, learning and processing, understanding the world around it. So that would count as a cognitive challenge. Next, we look at physical challenges. So physical challenges can be multiple, right? It can be gait training. So when somebody doesn't have an even gait, then music therapy plays a huge role in that through rhythmic entrainment. It could be fine motor movement. So the ability to use your fingers, to be able to pick up a spoon, to be able to write, to be able to even hold a pen before you can write. As well as gross motor movement. So it could be the ability to sit up and sit down and sit, stand up, or it could be being able to lift your arms and sit back down, or it could be even something as simple as being able to move your legs. Next, we look at social challenges. So impulse control is something that you see a lot in the population of autism, where they are unable to control certain impulses. Now, these impulses could be destructive. It could affect their behavior. It could affect their ability to be socially inept or socially adept, to be able to make friends, to be able to go outside, to even be able to sit in a classroom. And definitely communication skills, right? A lot of the times, differently abled individuals have difficulty in communication. It could be because of a cognitive challenge, or it could also be because of a behavioral challenge, which brings me to the next point, right? When you say behavioral challenge, we're looking at breaking certain behavior patterns and being able to redirect it into healthier coping mechanisms. Now, you don't even have to look at a differently abled population to know that we all have challenges when it comes to coping mechanisms, right? For some of us, it could be coping through food. For some of us, it could be coping through sleep. I know that the lockdown has been hard on all of us in different ways, and we're all finding ways to cope. But it is important to remember that some coping mechanisms are healthier than others. So when I work with my clients using music therapy, we look at how can we build healthy coping mechanisms. Finally, we come to emotional challenges, which is understanding and processing emotions and being able to use music as an outlet to express. Now, this is something that we're going to be doing today in one of our activities. So I'll speak more about that when we get to that. Now, this session is for music and how it can help in anxiety. So before we get into that, let's take a break and do an activity. What I would like you to do is find a comfortable position and stay seated, preferably with back support. Please close your eyes, focus on the sound of the guitar, and all I would like you to do is follow my voice, listen to the instructions, and just breathe with me. Give me a second while I get set up. In, 2, 3, 4, and out. 2, 3, 4, and in. 2, 3, 4, and out. 2, 3, 4, breathe in. 2, 3, 4, and out. 2, 3, 4, breathe in. 2, 3, 4, and out. 2, 3, 4. Now, continue that breathing pattern and notice how you breathe in for 4 counts and breathe out for 4 counts. Thank you. When you are ready, slowly open your eyes and come back to the session. So if you can quickly just type in and let me know, maybe in a few words or in one phrase, how that felt, that would be great. I'm looking at the chat box right now. Okay, so Hemant says that it was an amazing experience. Felt sleepy towards the end, relaxed, good experience. So a lot of you are saying either pleasant, relaxing, peaceful, sleepy, or refreshing, right? So if you look at anxiety, you have, anxiety is a spectrum, right? Any mental health disorder is a spectrum where we all fall somewhere in that spectrum. So it doesn't mean that if you are feeling anxious, you have an anxiety disorder, but feeling anxious has a whole lot of symptoms and causes that come along with it, right? So the cause of your anxiety could be, let's take the lockdown as an example. The cause of anxiety can be maybe your job, or it could be being stuck at home with, you know, 5 or 6 other members. It could be not being able to have the routine that you usually do, or it could be not being able to have access to some of the services that are a big part of your life, right? So we are all currently a little higher on the spectrum when it comes to feeling anxious than usual because of the situation that we are in. But here's the thing, it's not just us, right? The entire world is experiencing this kind of anxiety. And when you experience anxiety, one of the first things that happens, right from the first thought that comes into your head that you begin to worry about, the first thing that your body does to react to this is either your breathing gets shallow, right? Which means you are not breathing in deeply. So therefore your body isn't getting enough air and oxygen, right? And what happens as a result of that is your heart starts to beat faster. So if you look at it from a music perspective, we have something called tempo, right? So there is an app that I used right at the beginning called Metronome, which you can look up on your app stores after this webinar. But what that Metronome essentially does for me is it gives me a beat. So our resting heart rate is between 64 to 68 beats per minute. So if you are completely relaxed and if you are calm, right after maybe you come out of a meditation or right as you are about to fall asleep, your heartbeat is between 65 to 68 beats per minute, which is why so many of you felt so relaxed during this breathing exercise, because one, you were breathing in deeply. Two, you were breathing at a pace that allowed your heart rate to come to its resting position. So this is a great activity that you can do at home, right? You can find it multiple, yeah?
Sorry for disturbing you. Could you turn on your video?
Oh, sure, one second. I hope it doesn't mess with the audio, but let me just... There. Is this good? Is audio good?
Yes, ma'am. It's good. It's good.
Okay. So, wait, hold on. Sorry, the slide already went on to the next one. But okay. So one of the things that happens when you're anxious is that your heart rate goes up. And that's what causes the sweating. That's what also causes you to kind of progress in your thought loop, right? Or it might begin with, oh my God, I can't get my glasses fixed today because it broke. And then it could end up with, I don't know if I'm ever going to be able to see again. So a lot of the things kind of end up going to an extreme because of something as simple as our heart rate rising. So this is a great exercise for you to do on your own. There are playlists called 60 beat per minute playlists or meditation playlists on YouTube. I will share some of them with you in the chat box during our question and answer session. I'll share links to that. But you can use music or you can do something as simple as just download the Metronome app on your phone and just breathe with it. If you don't have time to sit and listen to music, you can do something as simple as just use the beats to breathe in and breathe out and therefore bring your heart rate to a resting position. If you have any questions about this, please go ahead and save it for our question and answer session, because we can elaborate on this activity and I'll talk about it more once we are done with the other activities that we have planned. So one of the other things that happens when we experience anxiety is that a lot of the times we end up holding it within, right? We think that, let me just speak for myself when I'm talking about this. A lot of the times when I get anxious about something, what I end up doing is I say, okay, I don't want to trouble anybody else with it. So I keep it all inside, right? Or sometimes if it's something that's really bothering me, then it ends up becoming frustration, right? I get irritated by my own thoughts and then it ends up with me having a fight with my mom because she made tinde instead of bhindi. It's something as simple as that. But what happens is that my emotions get misplaced. And because my emotions are getting misplaced, I'm not actually addressing what is causing anxiety. So over time, because I'm unable to express my anxiety or I'm unable to find a healthy outlet for it or a healthy way of expressing it to the people around me, what happens is that I end up keeping it inside. I either misplace it or one fine day I blow up like a hooker. So one of the really amazing things about music is how you can use it to express yourself without it being confrontational, right? How many of you growing up or even now for that matter, because I still do this, how many of you have playlists like of breakup songs that you've listened to maybe when you broke up with your first girlfriend or your boyfriend, or you listen to it when you feel sad? Or I have a playlist full of songs that when I really feel like I need to cry, I listen to that playlist and I end up crying, right? So since we have emotions, we have memories that are associated with music, we can use that music as a trigger to be able to express ourselves. Now, in this next activity, somebody's already they've started responding to this on the chat, but let me just quickly go through it. Let It Be is a very popular song by the Beatles, and I'll play it for you in just a minute. But what I would essentially like you to do is fill in the blanks with words that make sense for you right now. In this moment, how are you feeling? What is your situation? And I want you to go ahead and share it in the chat box below so that we can rewrite and sing this song together. So let me sing the original. When you are rewriting your responses, don't do it one line at a time. Do all three blanks. You don't have to type Let It Be at the end. Do all three blanks so that when I'm singing it, I can sing your entire response over there. So the original goes a little bit like this. When I find myself in times of trouble, Mother Mary comes to me, speaking words of wisdom. Let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. So Dr. Rupanjan Roy has responded, and his three words are stress, mom, and wisdom. So let us try that, okay? When I find myself in times of stress, my mother comes to me, speaking words of wisdom, let it be, let it be. Let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. And Mr. Anil Patel also has a response. So when I'm singing the let it be part, it's a simple part. I would love for you to join in and sing from your homes. So let's try this together. His words are, when I find myself in times of lockdown, my wife comes to me speaking words of homework or housework, I'm guessing, let it be. All right, so let's try that. When I find myself in times of lockdown, my wife comes to me, speaking words of housework, let it be, 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 speaking words of housework, let it be. All right, let's see, let's pick one more response. All right, Nicole says, when I find myself in times of aggression, my boss comes to me, speaking words of passion, let it be. That's lovely. All right, so let's try that, okay? When I find myself in times of aggression, my boss comes to me, speaking words of passion, let it be, 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 whisper words of wisdom, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be, let it be. Whisper words of wisdom, let it be. All right, so this is a great way in how you can express yourself. So a lot of the times we find it quite difficult to be vulnerable, or we find it quite difficult to be confrontational about our own emotions, right? So we know that we're going through a hard time within ourselves, but when it comes to actually communicating that to somebody else, it might not be the easiest. So I know that some people turn to writing as a way to do it. Some people turn to music or dance as a way to do it. And this is one of the many activities that you can use. So if you are a healthcare professional that's currently on the front lines and dealing with patients, you know, who have tested positive for COVID-19, or you're working with patients who are under quarantine, and you have a team that you are working with, a lot of the times, because of the stress, you might experience tension within your team. So taking just maybe 5 minutes to do something as simple as picking a song and singing it together, or picking a song and having people add to it like this, right? You can use the same template, or there are so many other songs, popular songs. Another one is We Shall Overcome, right? So We Shall Overcome Someday. So you can change those words too, right? We shall what? We shall be victorious. We shall come out of this, right? There are so many ways in which you can use simple songs, even something as simple as a nursery rhyme, and make it your own, so that you can find a way to express yourself without keeping it all inside and then finally exploding like a cooker, which most of us do, including me. All right, so I will answer any questions that you have about this in our question and answer session, but we have about 17 to 18 minutes left at this point. So as I'm bringing this session to an end, I definitely want to do it with more music. And I also want to allow enough time to answer your questions about music therapy and anxiety. So to end our activities with, I have something here called Coming Together Through Music. Go back and think about the responses that you posted in the chat box when I asked you about your first memory of music, right? You will notice that most of you shared how you remember or you have memories that has to do with a community. Some of you spoke about being in a singing class with other people. Some of you spoke about being in school. Some of you spoke about, you know, listening to bhajans and singing with your entire family. So there is no question about how the arts, right? It could be music, it could be dance, how the arts really help bring people together. It helps build connections that go beyond what words and sentences can communicate. So one of the things that you can definitely do at home when you feel like everybody is stressed or when you feel like everybody has their own things that they're getting stressed about, their own issues that they're dealing with, it could be working from home, it could be having to do all the housework. Just take a break in the evening before you sit down to watch a movie or before you sit down to have dinner or maybe even after dinner, right? Pick a song that you all know, pick a song that you all love and just sing together, right? And if you think that you don't like singing, you don't want to sing, then you can do something as simple as clapping along to music. You can play music, enjoy it, make it the center of an activity that you spend bonding with your family, your community, and even at work with your healthcare professionals. So what I would like to end with is a song from Lage Raho Munna Bhai. It's one of my favorite songs, and I have a lot of clients that love this song also. It's called Pal Pal, and you can either snap, you can clap along, you can hum or you can sing along. So I really hope all of you choose to sing along. It's a very simple song. And even if you don't get the words, there will be a second section where I'm just going to be singing la la la. So I hope you all join me then. And I really wish that I could have listened to all of you and we could have done this together, but maybe another time. All right, so let's get ready. पल 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 हर पल हर पल कैसे कटेगा पल हर पल हर पल 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 हर पल हर पल कैसे कटेगा पल हर पल हर पल दिल 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 में मची है हलचल हलचल कैसे कटेगा पल हर पल हर पल कैसे कटेगा पल हर पल हर पल ला 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 So now you know how that goes. Let's do it one more time. And this time, I really hope you're all singing along from home. Ready? 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Pal 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 har pal har pal kaise katega pal har pal har pal 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 har pal har pal kaise katega pal har pal har pal dil 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 mein machi hai halchal 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 kaise katega pal har pal har pal कैसे कटेगा पल हर पल हर पल ला 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 Thank you so much for tuning in. Thank you for staying with me, listening to me and joining me in all of these activities. We have about 13 minutes left. I would love to take your questions and answer them. Vaishali, if you would like to step in and moderate and kind of help me find the questions, that would be great.
Yes, ma'am, I'm here. This was such an amazing experience. Thank you so much on behalf of all of our audiences. So here is the first question. So one attendee is asking, when I'm too anxious, I get palpitations, which makes me uneasy. Since I mostly travel alone, will listening to music help me? Would you suggest some genre?
Sure. So actually, one of the things that I wanted to mention earlier on is that the genre of music doesn't really matter when it comes to music therapy, right? So it's not that you only have to listen to classical music for it to be music therapy, or you only have to listen to instrumental music. Any music that means something to you, that you have a connection with, can work during times of anxiety. What I will say is, remember the breathing activity, right? So the minute you notice that your heart rate is beginning to go up, the minute you notice, even before it gets to the palpitations, right, you can have a playlist ready. So Spotify is an app, and Spotify has multiple playlists that are 60 beats per minute, 70 beats per minute, between 60 and 70 beats per minute. So listen to a song like that, listen to a song from that playlist, or go on YouTube and find music that helps you calm down and just breathe. Breathing is the first step to bringing your heart to resting state, right? So you can listen to any genre that you enjoy. It can be old Tamil music, it can be Hindi music. I have clients that have worked through their anxiety listening to death metal, you know, and I've had to learn certain songs like by Iron Maiden and by Creed, and like kind of take that and go back to my session to help them deal with their anxiety. So don't worry so much about the music. Pick songs that make you feel good, that you have really good memories associated with, and use that as a way to help you regulate your breathing and therefore help with your palpitations.
Right. So we have another question, which is similar to this in relation to this. So it is, how can a layman identify which type of music to listen to in order to fight anxiety? Also, is the music therapy common type for all people, or a unique type of therapy needs to be used for each person?
So, like I said, when I was talking about what the definition of music therapy can be used for anybody. But one activity or one piece of music that might work for somebody that's dealing with anxiety doesn't necessarily mean that it can work for somebody else dealing with anxiety. So like I had said in my previous answer, when it comes to the type of music, go back to music that you have a personal connection with. It's not so much about the kind of music or the type of music as much as it is about how does that piece of music make you feel. And the only thing that I would want you to remember is, just like how when you're working out, you listen to fast-paced music, listen to medium-paced or slow-paced music so that you can entrain your breathing to it in order to deal with anxiety. Now, if you feel that despite being able to breathe along with calming music, you are still unable to deal with that anxiety, then chances are that you are not able to get out of your head, or that thought loop that you have that is causing the anxiety is a lot stronger to break through just breathing. In that case, find a song that you can either dance to, you can sing out loud in your room. Like for me, a lot of people in their 20s and 30s might relate to this, but Linkin Park, the band, was very popular when I was in high school, right? So when I was going through my troubled teenage years, there was one song by them called Numb, which is just, you know, like Chester screaming into the mic saying, I've become so numb, I can't feel you there. So that was the song of teenage angst. So a lot of the times for me, when I feel like I have a lot of frustration because of my anxiety and I'm unable to let it out, I go and listen to a song like that in my room on my own. You know, I put my headphones on, I listen to it. If nobody's around and they're not going to get disturbed, then I sing really loudly with it. But it's a way for me to let go of all of that energy. The same thing, you know, if you don't feel like singing, you don't want to do that, then put on a song that is high energy and just dance it out, right? Or work out. That's a great way to use music as a motivation to be able to tie it up with movement to release that excess and restless energy. So you can do that too.
All right, ma'am. So next question. I have gone through neurostroke 5 years ago. Sometimes with music, my headache cures, and sometimes headache increases with music while trying it sometimes. Please suggest which type of music to use.
Honestly, when it comes to so one of the things that I will first have to understand in this case is what are the after effects of stroke, right? So what are the challenges you are having? Is it speech related? Is it cognitive? Is it a cognitive challenge where you are unable to maybe process or understand certain things? Are you having difficulty with certain physical movements? Like, all of this matters. And when it comes to your headaches, I would ask you to pay attention to what kind of music ends up, you know, making your headache go away versus what kind of music creates a headache for you or makes it worse, right? Chances are maybe in the kind of music that you're listening to, there is some sound or there is some frequency that is stressing you out, right? So a lot of the times, if you listen to a piece of music closely, especially when it comes to electronic music, you'll notice that the frequencies vary a lot. You have a lot of high frequencies and you have a lot of low frequencies. At times like this, I would say, you know, listen to acoustic music, right? If you're not sure what is causing that headache or what is curing that headache, first pay attention to what kinds of music you're listening to. Second, experiment. So trial and error is the best. Let's say that there is a piece of music that you've listened to that, you know, you feel better after listening to it, then save it, right? Create a playlist for yourself. At the same time, also look at what are the memories that are being triggered by listening to this song. Maybe you're listening to a song that you really enjoy, that you've listened to all your life, but maybe you might have a negative association with that song. So be aware, follow where your mind is going, follow where your thoughts are going when you're listening to a piece of music, and look at what role that is playing in either helping with your headache or making it worse. But you can also get in touch with me, you know, going ahead, and I can help with more details. I can help with an assessment and help with more details and be able to answer that better.
Sure, ma'am. So we have two questions which are similar to each other. So I'll ask both of those together. One is from Dr. Rupanjan Roy and another is from Dr. Neeraj Kumar. Yeah. So Dr. Rupanjan Roy asks, about 90% of the patients experience anxiety and stress pre-extractions or pre-dental treatments. What will be the best way to relax them according to you? And a similar question by Dr. Neeraj Kumar, which music is good for clinic so that patients can listen during the treatment?
Okay, great. So for me, two years ago, I had three wisdom teeth extracted at the same time, right? And before I went in, what I did was I created an entire playlist for myself of music. So what I did was I started off with little fast-paced music because I get very anxious when I go to the dentist, by the way. It's always been the thing with me. So I created music that is fast-paced. So instead of using music that is very calming and soothing right from the beginning, I started off with a song that's a little fast-paced so that it matches my heart rate and it matches my anxiety. And then slowly, with every piece of music that I added in that playlist, I brought it down to a calming and soothing calming and soothing songs, right? So first two songs maybe were a little more upbeat, whereas the songs in the middle were very calm and soothing for me. So it met me where I was in terms of my anxiety and then brought me down to being able to stay calm during the actual dental procedure. And by the time I was done, because I had this music playing in my ear, I in fact didn't even notice when the doctor finished because my eyes were closed the entire time. So in terms of the songs that, you know, you want to play for your patients when they come in for dental work or even in any other clinic, one, I will definitely say that personal preference plays a huge role. But if you are looking to play music that is relaxing in general for your clinic, right, either in the waiting area or in the doctor's room itself, then I would say one, maybe go with instrumental instead of lyrics, because music with lyrics definitely affects us. Whether we realize it or not, when we listen to a song, we pick up on certain words and that can trigger certain associations that we have, or it can trigger a train of thoughts. So, you know, don't take a chance, go with instrumental music. And I will also say that pick instrumental music that doesn't have too many instruments going on, right? So you have instrumental music that you use for workouts, right? So like EDM, electronic dance music, or don't go for music like that. Instead, go for maybe acoustic music. So just a simple guitar and a piano playing, or something as simple as like if you are someone that enjoys Indian classical music, then go for something as simple as a sitar and, you know, a tabla that's playing. So one, think about music pieces that have minimal instruments, and also think about music pieces that are not exciting, right? So that music pieces that aren't where the melody isn't too complicated. A lot of the time, sometimes in classical music, you have certain pieces where the intricacy of the instrument is extremely high. So find music instead where it kind of stays neutral and stays, the where it starts is where it ends, right? It kind of has that same level of energy throughout the song. So those are just suggestions. But at the end of the day, if you are really looking to help with anxiety of your patients, ideally, I would say that it will have to be a personal choice of theirs. Actually, one second, Vaishali. One other thing that I could add to that personal choice is if you have, say, an Alexa or an Echo, or even if you have something as simple as like a portable Bluetooth speaker and an app like JioSaavn or Spotify on your phone, then you can just ask your patient what song you really enjoy, and you can actually play that for them during a dental procedure. So that could work too.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. There's another question. Are there any rules or regulations involved with musical therapy?
Definitely. One of the reasons why I stress so much on being a credentialed professional and also having studied music therapy is that you don't know what can, like how music can impact a client. So unless and until you are trained and you understand, even if something impacts your client negatively, the reason you need to be a trained professional is so that you know how to reject that negative impact. Right. So everything from understanding how music affects your brain and therefore how can you manipulate the five elements of music that I spoke about, which is melody, harmony, timbre, pitch and rhythm, understanding how to do all of that and how to manipulate that in order to be able to do the best for your client is very important. Second, there are a lot of rules and ethics that you are expected to follow, just like it is in the field of psychology and psychiatry. When it comes to your clients, you know, confidentiality is very important. Being able to like hold a safe space for your client is important, and also understanding and knowing that as a music therapist, you are only facilitating or guiding your client. You are not telling your client what to do and what not to do, or what to feel and what not to feel, right? So that is why going to therapy is different from sitting and talking to your friend when you are feeling anxious. So I would definitely say that, you know, ethics are extremely important when it comes to music therapy, and also having a really good understanding of music in itself, because music is the tool that you are using for therapy. So that's like me trying to be an English teacher without knowing English or without knowing English really well. So it's important to be able to understand music and to have a certain command over music so that you can change and adapt within a session, and you can improvise on songs and on your instrument and vocally also, so that you are giving your client what he or she needs and not giving your client what you can do. So at the end of the day, music therapy is not music performance and it's not music education either. In music therapy, it is all about your client, where at the end of the day, the goal of your client is not to be able to play the guitar perfectly or to be able to sing a song perfectly, but instead, what is that playing the guitar or what is singing actually doing for their physical, cognitive, behavioral, social, and emotional health?
Thank you, ma'am. That definitely gives us a clarity. We have a lot of questions flooding in, but then I think due to time constraints, we'll take this last question. That is, can you tell about music therapy courses available in India, and how do you think music therapy will develop in the next 10 years?
So one of the reasons why I moved back to India was because I wanted to help build the profession of music therapy here. There are short-term courses in music therapy currently. I teach on 2 expressive art diploma therapy programs, expressive arts therapy diploma programs. And one is at WCC in Chennai and the other one is at St. Xavier's in Mumbai. But currently we still don't have a certification for music therapy. So while we have a lot of individuals who, with good intentions, who are either musicians that are, taking on music therapy, or who might be psychologists that have a flair for music that are coming into the field, while we have a lot of people with good intentions, unfortunately, we still don't have a way to standardize it. So the first step in order to make music therapy a valid profession in India is that certification. Because once you create a standardization, then the quality of music therapy that you get, be it in Delhi or in Kolkata or in Mumbai or in Bangalore or Chennai, will be the same. So that is what we're working towards. I have a lot of friends in the profession, not just music therapists, but also dance and movement therapists, drama therapists, and art therapists. And we're all looking at coming together in order to create this standardization and to also make music therapy mainstream, make music therapy a household name. So sessions like this, again, I would love to thank you all for this opportunity. Like, thank you, Dr. Reddy's Foundation, for this. But sessions like this, where, you understand what music therapy really is and you get to experience a little bit of it, is one step in educating. So if you ask me, as a music therapist, what does your profession entail? Yes, I see clients. Yes, I do music therapy with them. But for me, educating people, educating the masses about music therapy is almost as important or even more important than music therapy itself at this point. So I would like to end with that. Hopefully in the next 10 years, there will be a lot of certified music therapists across the country that you can reach out to and that you can work with.
Hi, thank you so much, ma'am, for this amazing and refreshing session. With this, on behalf of Dr. Reddy's, I thank our speaker, Ms. Purva Sampath, and all our participants for taking time out and joining us for this session today. See you again tomorrow, same time, same place. Until then, stay home, stay safe. Thank you. Bye-bye.